Post office.
Post office.
But yeah, we did it.
Yes. Joined Gulen in 2021.
Right in the middle of COVID.
Yes, yes. I experienced COVID here.
Oh, so you managed to come here?
Yes, yes. During COVID, quarantine, every day. So I was all over the public event.
Ah, right.
Yes.
I'm Alina. I am... it's so interesting because I'm in two places. I'm actually here now as a on exchange program as faculty of languages and linguistics. But I am affiliated with Bardan Academy in Bangladesh. So here I'm going for a semester, and now the semester, to almost two semesters. But here I'm teaching linguistics and then discourse analysis. This semester, language in new media and technology. That's going to be interesting, considering that I'm not very friendly with technology. But yes.
I forgot to ask you what you teach. So are you just doing research?
Oh, okay. In my former university, I'm an assistant professor, so I have been involved in teaching more than 20 years.
All right.
So that's why I'm interested.
What university is that?
Ain Shams University.
Ain Shams, Egypt. Yeah, okay.
So that's why I'm interested in new methods and strategies in teaching and so on. So trying to catch up whatever experience, okay. Whatever technology that people are trying.
So did you get a chance to teach here?
Just lab demonstration, so this is not a serious teaching.
All right. Well, lab demonstration is... It's still a serious teaching, isn't it?
Not like lecture.
Okay. All right. So, you're teaching?
I'm teaching in chemistry for full-time degree. And for postgraduate research methodology in chemical chemistry.
This semester?
This is the only one class in chemistry.
So are you still on the admin course?
Yes, because I only admin course, that's why only one course.
Okay. So that's the thing with you have, if you're holding an admin course, you get reduced teaching load, but that admin load is actually is taking quite a lot of your time as well. So that's the thing.
That's why you have time. So that's why today I want to spend my time in order to improve my teaching. Quite
long, right? Yeah, since 2008. All right.
But
I'm also
the same
thing.
I'm the same
thing.
So
I'm like. So myself, my name is Zahir Budin. I'm the head of training now. Before I was a technology lead at Academic Development Center, or what we call ADEC. So. I also am a senior lecturer at Faculty of Built Environment. So I teach building pathology. Or what I would tell non-experts or laymen, the science of what goes wrong with buildings. So the blessing and the curse of that knowledge, of that expertise is every time I go into a building, I find defects. So I will see. So. There's always something wrong somewhere in the building. So that's the thing that I have. And this semester, apart from my admin course and that, I'm also teaching building procurement. So the process of buying buildings building procurement. And I also am given a new course, which is construction law.
Construction law,
yes. And I think it has something to do with my previous expertise, which is water surveying, and I have experience working in the industry for about 5 years after I graduated from my bachelor degree. So I know quite a bit on the legal aspect of building construction. the whole idea of having each construction course as well.
That was undergraduate.
These are undergraduate. I did not teach postgraduate this semester. I'm lucky in that sense. So I only teach the undergraduate this semester. Last semester, yeah, I have to do the postgraduate, which is a little bit more a little bit different than teaching undergrads, of course. And I think the level of thinking is different, and you get a lot of people from industry. So my course, those who are doing postgraduate mostly will be from industry. We got a lot of different perspective. It is challenging, and people talk a lot. Yeah.
Are you familiar with AIC?
Hmm?
AIC, International Arbitration Center.
Yes. I wouldn't say I am familiar with it. I know of its existence. I have never had contact around it, but. Arbitration is one of the aspects of construction law.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so since tell me, everybody have done the homework?
Yes, I didn't post
two years.
Okay,
I
didn't.
Yesterday I
cannot
log in.
I cannot enter
this one. Two of me
can
log in.
Okay,
got
that's
it.
Why.
Okay.
I realized first I was giving myself excuses and I thought it's really learning. This is after all what is now that I have to do first and then I come to the class. So, yes.
Okay, very good. Well, in normal situations, even with students, you will see or you will find that sometimes you will have instances where some students have completed the work that you gave them beforehand,
yes.
And some a small minority will not have sort of get the chance to do it because of many reasons. But I mean, it's part of doing learning anyway. So for those who have completed their sort of the pre-class activities. So what is the definition of flipped learning to you?
Okay, because I already finished the MRL teaching attempt, so
all right.
I have an idea about this. And I tried to look about, because really for the UML, I can find flipped learning clinics, so
okay.
I became interested. So what I got understood from that you provide the students with some demonstrations about the topic that is going to be in a discussion for the lecture. So they are getting prepared with some self-learning issues. Then they come to the lecture and the lecture is not a one-way, it is becoming like a discussion. So this is what I got understood.
Okay.
Yes, it's very similar. So I like the video where the founder of Flipped Learning, the initiator, forgot his name, but he was stressing the point that Flipped Learning is not about the videos, but it's about how you implement them and also make it as a process of the students gaining knowledge. So for instance, you can upload the video, you become a yeah, what else he mentioned, stressed, is that you need the lecturers need to be creators of their content. It's not necessarily they have to do everything from scratch new. They can find a video that they may think is useful with some presentation or something, but inside, during that presentation, during that video, insert some questions or comments, and the students are not basically able to proceed with the video rest of the lecture unless they answer this question. And then the one of the challenges that he's not he but others ask what if they don't do like you. No, it's great that we have an example because students just accountable. They come to the class and they have to watch this video, but they have to do it in class. While other students are already getting support from the lecture, and they ask questions, maybe I understood this, but I didn't understand that, may I have some more clarification? While they're already getting more and more, that student who didn't do homework is stuck doing it now. So eventually losing, and that student is learning. So that's one idea that I got, that we upload some content before. But it has to do with, when it comes to the technology, right? Not to, it already by default involves Spectrum or Moodle or things like that. They have access to online.
But actually, the technology in question doesn't have to be an online technology. You can even provide them with a sheet of paper with the content that you wanted to give for them to go explore first, and then during class, sort of discuss that. The challenge would be for you to be able to measure what they got from the piece of paper before you start with the learning session. Okay, so that's and I will try and explain it a little bit further down the line. But let's go to your experience first. So since it's good that you have not got the chance to go through the resources, what is deep learning to you before?
Before I answer all these questions just now, I thought the deep learning is like very learning concept.
Okay.
So then I try to do this, oh, it's not like 100% like very learning, am I right?
Yeah.
It's not. So then I say, okay, of course I don't know anything about deep learning, so I have to learn from Zahid today. So, but the idea is I know that the deep learning is like the provide the method skills activity before the class, am I right?
Yes.
And then the student have to do, then they start. Then once they come to class, so they can have more discussion with
one thing that is key here is the educator, lecturer is no longer a stage on stage.
Yes.
Not like we are the center of attention and students are listening. No, now we become more of a facilitator.
Yes, so exactly.
We come back to with what they learn.
Yes.
Exactly. So the challenge is actually, or the skill that you need to develop is actually the skill to become a facilitator in the classroom.
Yes.
So that's the thing. And what I think the important part of that preparation for the class session is actually the measurement or the assessment of what the students have already been learning before the class. So I think that make flip learning the powerful tool, because now it gives you the leverage to know. So let's say you have 3 learning outcomes. So you know which learning outcome of the 3 that you give the content on and that you assess them on before class that they have already understood and that they have already got. So you can actually design the class where you leave those things behind. So the learning outcome that the students have already attained, everybody have got this, so you don't have to worry about it. So let's work on learning outcome number 2 and number 3. And then you can actually single out those who may be struggling with learning outcomes number 1. And okay, you can put them in a group together, for example, and so start helping them to sort of make them understand that, while the rest of the group will have a differentiated learning path where they now focus on maybe learning about number 2 or learning about number 3, or if they have already sort of mastered the 3 learning outcomes, then you can put them into a more advanced sort of state or go into advanced stage of learning with that learning outcome, so that then they can adapt or they can do something else with the knowledge that they have. So that's where I think the flipped classroom is pretty powerful. You can leave behind things that students get, because sometimes our learning outcomes are quite simple, isn't it? And we want them to be able to, we don't want to bore students with the things that they have already known. And we want them to sort of advance further. And when you have the opportunity to do that before class, then you know and you can redesign your learning approaches so that then students feel challenged, students feel engaged, because they are trying to figure out things that they don't know or things that they are struggling with. So that's where the flipped learning idea comes in. Okay? So so your flipped learning score. Okay. Well, it doesn't matter. It's not a competition.
Yeah,
it's just an assessment for yourself.
Just about being honest with yourself.
Yes.
But flipped learning, so the classroom then is bound to be noisy. Right?
Yes.
There is not going to be just one group or students listening to the lecture anymore.
Yes.
Someone didn't get learning outcome one while the rest are already advancing. So it would be all about group work,
differentiated learning, personalized learning. So all the sort of the buzzword that we are hearing now in education, we can actually design it better if we do flipped learning.
So is it safe to say that it's going to be way more work for the lecture preparation?
What the preparation, I would say it would be
for the first time.
For the first time, yes.
For the second time,
yeah,
less.
Exactly. When you are prepared, then anything can be done. So even when you are doing lectures, so of course you need to prepare, isn't it? So you cannot come in and then empty-handed.
But in this case, if we see that they somehow miraculously got everything,
okay,
all these learning outcomes, we need to come up with more advanced things to teach them, right, to engage them, because
yes,
they already got what we have.
So you throw problems at them. See whether they really understood that those learning outcomes. That's part of assessment as well.
Normally, we do all these activities, the students are supposed to do one day before. For example, is it?
It depends on.
How
you can give them 3 days before, you can even give it to them a week before, so after the last.
After the last class.
Mm-hmm. So let's say your last class with them is on Thursday.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so before next Monday or before next Wednesday, Tuesday, when we meet, so this is the thing that I want you to do. Make sure you do the content and also go through the content and do the assessment, so that I know what to teach you on Tuesday or what we are going to explore on Tuesday.
And is it okay to have flipped learning every single session, or is it part just?
Okay, so I think that there will be a sort of discussion around that. Okay, so so if you don't mind sharing, so what's your flipped learning score?
510.
510.
It's 540. 500.
Okay. Never mind. I think it will be the sort of. This is the pre-test. So later.
To do another
yes.
test.
And then when, let's say after 3 weeks, I want you to do another test and
no.
see whether your learning score is progressing upwards. Okay? So, and it's a good measure. Huh? No, I'm not going to monitor you. I have no business policing people. So you will monitor yourself.
You're just the list of construction.
So the reason why I designed this with that first is so that I want, so it's not like I want you to get low scores. It's I want you to sort of start to think and reflect on what you have been doing. And the scores is just an indication of whether you have done something similar to Fitbit. Okay. And what I wanted out of it is for you to then start to build up your skills so that then you can reassess yourself and the score is going to be higher. Okay. Alright, so and I designed the whole sort of experience here so that I would say from my personal experience, this would be one of the sort of good ways for you to do flipped learning with your students. So I designed it so that it has a sequence, so you realize that I have numbered it 1, 1.1, 2, up to 6. So it gives the learners a sense of direction. This is the first thing that you do, the second thing you do this. So because we want to give them the content, but we want them to be able to do it sequentially, isn't it? So that's why I sort of numbered it that way. And another thing that I put in, if you notice, is the time it takes for each activity. So why do you think that is important? Anyway. Yes, get your students. What else?
Okay, for any topic, usually there is a flow to give the knowledge. So usually you cannot jump all over the way. So sometimes you need to establish some fundamentals and basics understanding. Then you can move over.
Exactly. So in education, that's called scaffolding, isn't it? So my question now is, why do I put the time?
Oh,
this thing requires 3 minutes. This thing requires 6 minutes.
Okay, so the learner can understand how much time he has to spend to finish all this.
Okay.
Sometimes maybe you ask them to finish all in one session.
Okay.
One time. And maybe sometimes you can ask them, you can do it like a discrete. This one in 1 day, this is another day, fine. So then he can schedule his time.
Alright. What about you?
I think our super busy life for everyone, even the students who think they're busy, but they're busy scrolling down Instagram. But anyway, the attention span is very short. And I think it's also kind of psychological. If you think, okay, it only takes 7 minutes, I can spend time on that. But if I see 15 minutes, 20 minutes, or whatever, maybe scientifically it's been already established, then there's less motivation to do that. Even me myself, yesterday, totally my experience, I saw that. And I thought, okay, I have to do it. And then I looked at the time, oh, it's only 7 minutes here.
Because sometimes, we are busy people, isn't it? So if we don't see any sort of time indication of time, how much this activity is going to take, then you are less likely to just to say, want to try it. Okay, I don't know how, if I start doing this, I might take 3 hours to finish. So psychologically, you put the time there so that you know, okay, this actually takes 3 minutes. That's the number one. And then number two, if the learner takes more time, so let's say this activity is a 3-minute activity, but the learner ends up doing it for 15 minutes. So the learner would come to a self-realization that, okay, this is something that I'm struggling with. So that's another thing that you want out of that feedback. But you need to actually tell these things to the learners, to the, isn't it?
And you're able to see how much time they spend?
No, I don't. So it's all, because when you go into adult learning, it's always the reflective process, isn't it? So, and you want to have that stress to the students, and you design it, number one, by telling them to do and reflect, blah, blah, blah. But at the same time, you design it sort of subtly by putting these cues like this. So those are the things that is, I would say, quite, it's small, but it's actually quite meaningful. So that is where the time comes in. Wait for it to come. So that's the activity number one. So let's look at so has anybody been able to upload their so nobody has
what was when I tried to click on my score, it says non-validation thing. What does that mean?
Did you put in your email address?
Yes.
Okay, so try and search for the score there.
let's reverse where traditional homework and lecture take place. Now, I must warn you beforehand, watching this presentation can literally turn your world upside down. The first thing most educators are going to ask is, why flip? Well, here are a couple reasons to consider. With a flipped classroom, the content becomes available to students beyond typical classroom time. Students are now able to access the content anytime. Benefit that comes with viewing content in video format is the ability to stop, pause, play, etc. Students can write down questions about the content at home. Then, when students enter the classroom, they are already prepared to ask these questions to their teacher. When a teacher flips a classroom, that teacher is able to walk around the room. Ultimately, flipping a classroom frees up time for teachers to work with students individually. Now, let's take a quick break to think about how our students are used to acquiring knowledge.
So,
sorry.
What's the answer to that? First one,
students can access the content anytime.
Okay, so let's try that. Number one.
Will we be able to make a video today by ourselves like this?
Yes.
How? Oh,
definitely.
Nice.
Students of today mostly learn from their phones and computers. Students of today are comfortable with the flipped model because it's how they usually access knowledge. Lastly, we know some students learn faster than others. Flipping a classroom allows teachers to personalize learning. Now, how do you flip a classroom? What steps should you take? Right now, I'm going to outline an 8-step pad that I have successfully used to flip my classroom. Each step is represented with a star. The first step in flipping a classroom begins with the buy-in. Get your students, parents, and administrators on board with the flip model. Step 2, curate the resources you need to flip a classroom. These are resources for instruction, such as YouTube video, online worksheets, quizzes, electronics, etc. Now, moving on to the actual first day of class, classroom management is required for a flip model, just like a traditional model. Very early on, be sure to spend time and incorporate expectations and procedures, as this learning style may be new. Number 4 is technology training. Teachers need to learn how to curate videos through YouTube channels and create playlists, and students must be able to access and interact with online content. Now we get to the actual flipping. And the number 5 is assigned content for homework. Students will access content through videos, hyperdocs, interactive PowerPoints, slides, and much more. Next up, number 6. Students work on problems during class time. Students get to work on the application of skills in class, where a teacher walks around the room and facilitates and helps students as needed. Moving on to number 7, independent learning.
Okay. Question.
Step 6.
Students work on problems in class.
Okay, so the answer is obvious, isn't it?
Yeah. With a flipped classroom, students become independent learners and have the ability to move to the curriculum at their own pace. And the last star in the sky, number 8, peer tutoring. Pair up your advanced students who mastered the content beforehand with students having a hard time completing the problems.
Okay, so before we move on, so if you look at this steps, the start, what do you think would be easiest to do?
Easiest to do?
Yeah.
For the indicator or for the
Which one?
For the learner or for the educator?
Both. For learner or educator. If you want to look at it from perspective of the educator, yeah, you can do that. You can also look at it from the perspective of the learner.
I would say the last step.
For the educators, because they learn by themselves.
Yes. See, the peer tutoring is between students.
Yes. Yes. That's why we give them the assignment.
No, actually, this one, I did, from my understanding, that some students during the class can explain something to other students.
Yes.
And for some, it can be difficult because they may have understood but not know how to explain it best.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, fair enough. It does sometimes work like that.
Maybe technology training. I don't know how that's not the
easy. Technology training is really free, training for the educators.
For the educators.
Classroom management may be a bit challenging in the beginning to know how to manage it best.
Yeah.
And different people do different things.
So have you had the experience, any of you had the experience of in this kind of classroom where a different group do different things?
Yes, but usually just for a limited period of time when they are okay, here's a report, you need to think about the advantages of using this and you guys need to think about disadvantages. So they work maybe 10, maybe 30 minutes and then they present their results. But that's just one activity, but this is going to be the whole class coming around this.
So I think when you are able to do that short activity, 30 minutes, 60 for example, you can then scale it up for the whole class to do that. It just needs a little bit more planning and design.
Mm-hmm. You don't really feel like, indeed, you are more walking around the whole time, not anymore. Okay, you all listen to me.
Yeah, so that's where the stage of the stage and guy on the side thing goes.
Exactly. I'm not really thinking that you have to walk around all the time. Sometimes you can catch there's a common mistake on the learners. So maybe you have to grab their attention and make it correct.
Yes, exactly. So there are times where you will have to do that. So when you are jumping in between groups, for example, so you notice this group is making that error, for example, and then that group makes the same error, and then this group also makes the same error. So then you can actually stop the session for 5 minutes or 10 minutes. Okay, so and then sort of slowly bring them back to what is supposed to be the way that they're thinking or what the knowledge is about, and then you can actually get them to go back and do their. So yeah, I mean, classroom management is something that is a little bit more challenging. The easy part is actually to assign the homework, isn't it, for the learners.
But there is also some challenges.
Yeah.
Maybe you assign them something that is not well modeled.
Yes.
Then they become confused.
Okay.
But the act of assigning is easy. And then you deal with it.
Then you want it, then it will be difficult.
Well, then you assign homework after you give the content, is it? Or with the content? I would argue that you sign the work with the content, it's better. Like what we do with the video.
Yeah.
So you give them small chunks,
you
assess. You give them small chunks, you assess. So similar to this video, I give you just this section that you will watch, isn't it? And then answer a question. And then there are another two that you need to watch, and I ask you a question. So it gives them the confidence that, okay, after I listen to this, this is the answer, or this is how it's measured. Then you able to see students gaining more confidence because they know they can answer it. Okay. And if they cannot answer it, then they can always go back. So that's where the video comes in when you are doing fit learning, isn't it? So it allows the learning content to be sort of reverse, rewind back, and then students see where they are struggling, and then they can focus on that before they move on. Okay. And it does not just work on videos only. It will always, it will work with like articles, when you get them to read. Journal article, I find a bit challenging for students to handle. What you can do is you highlight the parts that you want them to focus on. And then you ask questions on that part.
Under the articles, like under, we upload the article and then under that we ask questions or
you, so with article you need to sort of be creative with it.
Quiz?
Is a quiz, some sort of like quiz. I actually have that step at the bottom where I give you something to read and then you answer questions based on what you prepared. Okay? So let's move on.
So we measure their understanding by the answers they provide,
yes.
Right? The embedded questions that they have, and then we can see the name of the student.
Yes, exactly.
And we can see his score or her score.
Yeah.
But can we also see where exactly the name is stated, or just the general score?
Yeah, you can actually see the where exactly where they are. Okay. So let's move on and continue up until the end, and then I can show you where the score comes up. Then using puzzle.
So, what does it actually look like? The traditional model has students attending school where content is delivered by teachers. And students going home to work on problems. But here, we're getting rid of that model and replacing it with a flip model. In the flip model, students work on problems when they are at school. And when students are at home, content is delivered online.
Okay, great.
So actually, the content is delivered, so basically it's not just self-study. The students still get access to the lecture, but this lecture is recorded.
Yeah, and it doesn't have to be a lecture.
Yeah, it doesn't have to. It can be just through different
article,
or textbook that you need to read some chapters.
It can be, so in a video, it can be things like interviews,
mm-hmm.
or documentary, or even movies.
So the phrase content delivered doesn't necessarily mean that the teacher is the one delivering to you. You are getting this content from other sources that the teacher
recommends. Okay. So if you remember that word that they use, is curated content.
Yes.
The function of a curator in a museum is actually to acquire things from different places.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't it? So this piece of art is drawn by XX, what number? The name? Yeah. So this another piece of art is from which civilization? So the curator actually compile all these things together and exhibit it in the museum. So that's why they use the word curate. It doesn't have to be that we prepare everything by ourselves.
Yeah.
Isn't it? We can actually source those content from different places.
Mm-hmm.
We are the ones who compile it, put it together in a sequence or in a way that you know or you... It is your best guess that this is how the students will learn efficiently. Goes back to your philosophy. Are you a constructivist? Are you a behaviorist? Isn't it? So me, myself, I subscribe to the constructivist approach, where it is up to the students to build that knowledge. And they build that knowledge through the content, and then the application of that content. Because what is knowledge and what is information? What are the difference between those two? So let's think about that. So this is what the answer to this?
They
work. Okay. So before we click on submit, so let's discuss knowledge and information. So what's the difference? What's the difference between knowledge and information? Anyone wants to start?
For me,
okay.
Knowledge is a higher level for information.
Okay.
So maybe I can attend the lecture, I get some information from that, but doesn't mean that I reach the knowledge.
Okay.
I get the knowledge.
Okay. So anyone else?
Information is something I do agree here with you. Basically, information is about facts or anything that you may hear of, you may get an idea of, but how you operate this information. This is already the next level, which is knowledge. That you know how to use that, how to apply that information. You know how to discuss it, the knowledge is the ability to operate information.
What's the difference between the information?
For me, is, for example, when you say that you provide the lecture notes, I think that is like the for the first time, there's a CD, maybe for them, it's like there's information for them. Then, truly, after they understand everything, for them, it's a knowledge.
I would say it is similar to what Zakaria
Mahmud or Zakaria
okay.
said.
And Alina. So sorry, I'm reading back.
Oh, very good.
I'm
sorry. Sharifa. Where is it?
Mahmud. So it's this. You are telling what these two are saying, but in a different way, isn't it? So information is everywhere, isn't it? So
yes.
That's information. Everything that you see is information.
Yes.
But when you start to internalize the information and you start to be able to use the information, then it becomes knowledge, isn't it? So that is where you want the students to go to. Okay? And when we show them a video, unless we get them to operate on that video, so using your word, operate on that information from the video, then it does not become knowledge yet. Isn't it?
All right.
So once you are able to then process that and work on problems, for example. So that becomes knowledge because they are able to take that information and they can do something with it. So that is the difference. And what we wanted to design for the people learning is to for them to get into the knowledge side of things. And that's why we assess. Okay. So we can assess very surface like this. So this is very surface assessment, isn't it? So you see that information, and then you basically you are asking them to first regurgitate that information in any way. So like this, you are answering questions just after you watch that same video. But you can actually go higher, where you ask them to process the information. But in order for the students to be able to process the information, you need to give them a little bit more. So, and you give them context. Okay, that's another thing. Context to use the information.
Here are a couple tools you may need when flipping a classroom. YouTube will allow you to provide video lessons. Social media can help disseminate content. Devices to access online content. Google Doc links, slides to learn content, and sites to find the content. Readings can be used as well.
Okay.
Right now, I'd just like to
one thing I like about Edpuzzle is you can use answer with audio. So you see this? You can actually click and you record your audio.
This is us who decide whether this option is applicable or not, right?
Yes.
Audio.
Okay, so question to you. What is the one possible challenge that you may face using Flipped Classroom model, and what could you do to solve that issue?
I think during these videos or something that I watched yesterday, maybe it came to my mind that one challenge could be if you are not sure whether this problem particularly works because you've never tried it before, you can't really assign it until you know for sure if it works. Because when we are in class, we can say, oh no, that's not working out. It has to be readjusted a little bit. So this could be a challenge. So we just need to make sure whatever we assign them, it's been tested, run, and we cannot just see and rely that they will figure it out.
Okay. So how do you solve that?
Try first in class. You talk to your peers. Have you tried that?
That's how we solve the problem, isn't it? Sometimes we need to test things first. Sometimes, I would say it's not that unethical to test on the students first, a group of students first, and then you come back to them in the next week and tell them what's up. So this is actually what I'm trying to do. It does not really sort of work. So let's try another thing. Because they still are learning in the process of failing. Students are actually still learning, isn't it?
Right. Just, I guess we need to be ready because the case that the next class we come, they may say, oh, we didn't understand what you wanted from us.
Yeah.
So just be prepared that, and you know, not be surprised or something. Just be ready. This can happen and be cool with this.
Yes.
And move on and just and see what. Because sometimes we are also learning from students, of course.
Exactly.
They notice something we didn't even think about when we assigned this thing to them.
Yeah, exactly. So that's the answer. What about you, Sarifa?
I think this is my challenge last semester. I don't think this is a flipped classroom, I would say, but I'm trying to keep my pre-recorded lectures before my class. So I already tell them that everyone agree that the student have to listen first. And then once come to my class, we do some solving question that someone during the discussion. So after a few, then I noticed that some of the students, like me, didn't do the commitment before and didn't join my class. And then when I do give them comment and criticism, ask them the students to give a feedback about my teaching, some of them they say very good, the way they can enhance their understanding, but some of them, I think, like 50% say it's okay, they did very good. For them, 50% say that for them it's quite difficult because they don't have time to listen to my video, even if it's like 3 minutes. But inform them, maybe my fault, but they only say that okay, say 5 minutes. They just give okay, this video is less than 5 minutes, like through the WhatsApp groups. So some of them say they don't have time to listen, they don't understand. They say that so when in my lectures, normally I can just run through the notes because I summarize it. So they say that please don't skip the notes, skip the lecture notes. So for them that I've skipped, I say that I won't skip. I summarize it because already give you the pre-recorded lectures and so on. So my challenge is about the student participation in the commitment, their commitment before the class.
This is probably something that can be dealt with if we, like it was there, buy-in, first step. Everybody has to be understanding what it is. And after all, it's either even traditional teaching and learning. They get the content, then they go home, and they must spend time.
Yes.
Here, it's exactly the same time you spend, but before the lecture.
Before, yeah.
It was also in that video yesterday I watched where some may say, oh, the teacher is not teaching anymore. What's this? They just didn't get the idea that it's the same, but flipped.
Yeah.
You still do the work, but more effectively before the class, and then we just head on, do the challenges, face challenges you have. So maybe more information has to be given to them before we start.
Maybe for them it's like a, it's a something new for them, maybe. But actually this is 30 years of this. So, so I think that is, I think that is our main problem.
So it's actually what that means actually managing expectation. And I have a first-hand experience, the error of in managing expectation. And so the first time I started to change the way that I teach, I did not tell the students that I was going to do that. So what happened, I get a lot of resistance from the students. Because I did not sort of tell them, okay, so this is what we are going to do. And I only knew about it when I got my CTAS results. Okay? So, and I was like, rated really, really poorly for that.
I'm not teaching.
And, there's one sort of comment from the students, which is, I think to me, it's funny. I don't know whether they, that student when he or she wrote this, realized or not. So the comment goes something like, why is this lecturer making us learn in his class? And I mean, that is the reason why you come to university, isn't it? For you to learn. So I don't know whether that person realized that this is what's supposed to happen.
I have one thing. Okay, for the students, they kept on a conventional way of teaching from first year of first grade until they finally evolved to university. Then come suddenly and tell them there is a teacher. There is a new way, you have to read. Oh, there is a shock.
Uh-huh.
So changing the culture is usually very difficult, especially at this age. The second one, this is my students who come to university to someone who is eager to learn and get more knowledge. So I'm not here again like a primary school teacher. So I'm telling him you have to do that and you have to do that. Sometimes he has to be self-dependent on getting the knowledge. Then he can come and discuss so he can get there. For my experience, I was teaching a course called mechanical machine design. So in this way, usually it is a problem. We give them the problem and they have to make a machine or design a machine, do the calculations, so on. So there is no one perfect solution. It's not an equation. They have to develop their own. So it's working on the groups. So sometimes they feel like what you say, what are we doing? So it's basically you have to arrange some fundamentals and basic understanding for kinematics, mathematics, physics, and put them how to solve the problem. So sometimes they're not aware about this kind of topic or subject or way of learning. Maybe you have to give them the awareness. Maybe you have to change the culture. But it takes time and it takes some effort.
Yes, exactly. And from the feedback from the students, because I see them the next semester. The mistake that I did was I did not explain to them how they will be learning. the next the first time I told them. So after I did that, so actually they can accept it. And there are some students who come to university expecting to be lectured.
Yes.
Isn't it? And being a research university as that we are, I told them, so this is actually based on research and literature. And they immediately are able to sort of appreciate why this shift is there. So I think that's, again, it answers to, it reflects back to what you said just now. Classroom management, one aspect of it is actually preparing the students to undergo the learning that we are going to design for them, which normally would be slightly different than the lecturing. So I tell the students, even yesterday with my first class, I tell the students, don't come to my classes expecting a lecture. You will not get lecture. I don't give lectures. And I don't also give them lecture notes. So I have been lecture noteless since 2014. And the students can accept that, and they are able to try based on the result they have shown, and also the feedback that I got from the students with the CTEX.
So it's okay not to have lecture notes, because okay. They basically, they learn, they are the ones making their own lecture notes.
Yes. So you tell them about that constructivist approach to teaching and learning. And then they will be able to understand that. Okay, so let's have a 10 minutes break. So we have food outside.
Four of us. Four of us.
I think maybe I'll give you a break.
Because there's food outside.
Oh, okay. Okay. Because there's food.
So
that's
and then we can continue. And afterwards, I'm going to show you the kinds of technologies that we are going to do, use.
Design. Yes.
Oh, yes. That one we need. Yang macam ni. Ini pause ke tak? Thank you. Yeah.